Some people call me the space cowboy. Yeah. Some call me the gangster of love. Some people call me Maurice. Cause I speak of the pompous.
Greetings, fellow Tightwads, fellow Cal football fans, fellow Cal athletic sports fans, wherever you are tuning in from on what for us is, of course, a Saturday night. For you, of course, on this YouTube exclusive of this show, it's whatever the bloody hell time it is that you're tuning into it at this point in time. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the second edition of the Bear Raid presented by Tightwad Hill. What's going on, everybody? It is the 30th governor of Tightwad Hill, Keith Salminen, and coming at you from Donnie's pad out in Concord, California. Unfortunately, we tried to get the Wi-Fi working out here. For some reason, it did not work. But luckily, given the fact that on this show, this guy that you're hearing from right here right now happens to have nearly two decades of experience of doing podcasts because of being involved with A's Fan Radio and Raider Fan Radio, I know ways to get around still being able to do a show. So for this one, obviously, it's a YouTube exclusive, and you, of course, are viewing it on A's Fan Radio's YouTube channel. Hope you all are doing good out there tonight. A little bit of a disastrous day, unfortunately, for your California Golden Bears. We'll, of course, get into that when we recap the Oregon State game about midway through this evening's broadcast. But enough hearing from me. Let's go ahead and bring on board one of the other two members of the inaugural cast for the Bear Raid. Of course, many of you already know, y'all heard my crazy ass for the entirety of our debut show last Sunday night. Still waiting to find out when exactly he will be popping in on the broadcast, because there's no reliable way to get a hold of him. So if anybody in Berkeley happens to see him anytime soon, tell Tad Dillinger III to get a hold of me so we can get him on this damn podcast, and also let him know about the big game viewing party that's going to be going down next week, which we will discuss about more later on in the show. But let me go ahead and introduce to y'all one of the other members of the Bear Raid cast, and the individual, of course, who's supporting the location for the broadcast tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, let me go ahead and introduce y'all to Donnie Knucklehead Hudson. Hey, Donnie, what's up?
Hey, thank you very much, Keith. This is my debut. Never done radio before, but I'm looking forward to a lot of fun covering football, some basketball, Cal sports in general. We're out here in Concord having a good time, Keith. Thank you.
Donnie, of course, is an individual who you might have heard call into some broadcasts before on 95.7 The Game. Ended up, of course, getting known for reading some poems that he wrote over the last couple of years that were Cal-inspired, that he read either on opening day or the big game or whatever would be our big equivalent opponent matchup that year if the big game wasn't in Berkeley, so, you know, USC, UCLA or whatnot. Since, obviously, Donnie was not able to join us for last week's edition of the show, we're going to go ahead and spend the first of the three segments on tonight's broadcast basically hearing what Donnie plans to bring to the Bear Raid, his take on Tightwad Hill, of course, being closed in 2020, and his thoughts on the disappointing 34-10 loss that your Golden Bears suffered against the UCLA Bruins, a.k.a. the Dickless Bears, last week. So, Donnie, first things first, of course, what do you basically plan on bringing to this Cal-themed podcast that yours truly and others have been trying to get off the ground for the last decade?
Well, I'm going to help you with football, of course, but I know a lot about basketball, and I'm going to cover the women's and the men's Cal basketball this season. We're going to have some fun doing that. You know, you can't get into the gym, but we're still going to have fun.
Obviously, everybody, of course, last week heard my thoughts and my take and basically got the whole spiel on Tightwad Hill being shut down for the 2020 season. You're an active member of the Tightwad Hill Facebook group. Obviously, you post stuff every now and then as well on the Facebook page, but, you know, really kind of haven't seen you share your direct thoughts out there on the hill being closed. So I guess right here, right now for everybody, what's your take on us not being able to use the hill in 2020, and obviously depending on, you know, going forward, whatever the length or length per se of this pandemic is.
Well, we got to be safe than sorry, and we got to follow the doctor's rules. And I dearly miss my Cal football and my Hill. I went out there and checked it out. It was so sad. Couldn't even get into practice. You know.
Donnie, by the way, was one of the individuals who, of course, went up there before we got the official word that the Hill was going to be shut down. Of course, when all that talk was going on about, oh, there's a fence up there, that means the Hill's going to be blocked off. And, of course, many of us who've gone up there regularly have known that the said fence has been up there in place pretty much for damn near almost last 10 years. But, you know, obviously he went up there, took a look. I went up there, took a look, kept in contact with the school. And, of course, as we all found out, obviously because of concerns of the how this can get spread and all that. And let's be real, even though many of you out there knew that we were going to try to have some sort of social distancing and face mask policy in place in 2020, let's be real. Some of y'all, when y'all get alcohol in y'all, weed in y'all, both of the above, or whatever the bloody hell it is you partake in to have a little extra fun, guidelines and standards probably go out the window at that point, so kind of understandable why they shut it down. And, you know, pretty much, you know, as you all can see, Donnie's pretty much in line with, you know, a lot of the rest of us. While it sucks, unfortunately, it is what it is, and we have to understand what the school and the city of Berkeley have to do. Last thing as well, Donnie, your thoughts and basically your recap of last week's matchup against UCLA and what unfortunately went down with Cal in that one is, of course, they dropped that matchup to the Dickless Bears by the final score of 34-10.
Oh, that baby bear game last week, that was terrible. You know, we could have had 14 points right out the gate. We blocked that punt. We really messed up. I want to recap about the Tightwad Hill. You know, I miss my friends out there, too. I really miss seeing all the people at Tightwad Hill. All the, you know, it's a yearly thing we do there, and we don't all congregate all during the year. So I really miss that, and I just want to say hi to all the friends out there.
Any other thoughts you have on last week's matchup?
It was just terrible. Garbers didn't look that good. The running back got injured. The line was sick, of course, and we can make all the excuses we want, but it just wasn't cool.
Hey, it is what it is. We know what happens. You know, obviously it's a year where even Joe Starkey, of course, said it himself during last week's broadcast. It's really a season, given the circumstances of the pandemic. You really got to kind of take everything week to week at this point and basically hope for the best, but prepare for a cancellation. Obviously, that did not end up happening for your California Golden Bears when they, of course, ended up playing this week, but let's just say a back-and-forth game that we all thought maybe we would have ended up winning ended up not being the case. We, of course, will recap that matchup with the Oregon State Beavers following our first break of the night here. Don't go anywhere, folks. The second edition of the Bear Raid, presented by Tightwad Hill, will be right back at you in a bit.
Did I do that?
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, as we continue on down the road here with the second edition of the Bear Raid presented by Tightwad Hill. It is, of course, the 30th governor of Tightwad Hill, Keith Salminen, joined alongside by Donnie Knucklehead Hudson. We're coming at you from Donnie's pad out in Concord, California. Obviously, of course, having a little bit of issues with getting the Wi-Fi to work out here, so y'all are dealing with what will be a YouTube exclusive. We're only two shows in, and we're already doing YouTube exclusives on this bad boy. But hey, like I hinted at earlier, that's one advantage that you have when the producer of this young broadcast happens to have experience in this field over the course of the last two decades. Let's go ahead now and continue on down the road hitting things with here in tonight's broadcast. Of course, we will go ahead and recap what went down earlier this afternoon up in Corvallis, Oregon, as, of course, your University of California Golden Bears partook in their second game of this shortened 2020 season, taking on the Oregon State Beavers. Cal, of course, going into this game with an 0-1 record. Oregon State was heading into this matchup with an 0-2 record. Kind of a little bit of a shaky first half. Cal right out the gate after Oregon received the ball. Literally, Oregon State's first play from out the gate was a 80-plus yard run for a touchdown. Putting Cal in an early hole. Cal was able to recover and ultimately get on the board with an outstanding a very outstanding drag catch by Malaki Polk, I believe.
That's right, Mr. Polk.
Okay, yes, doing a nice little drag catch there with the feet there. Obviously, of course, we all know in college football you just need to have 1 foot in bounds, but still, some of these guys would ultimately want to get to the NFL. They try to get into the mindset of keeping both feet in bounds.
That pulled it 7-7.
Yeah. That, of course, ultimately would tie up the game at 7-7 in the first quarter, but it would be a short-lived lead or tie game for your California Golden Bears, at that point, as with 5:47 left to go in the first quarter, OSU would get a 35-yard touchdown pass to take a 14-7 lead. That's basically how things would end in the first quarter, with OSU up with a 14-7 lead at that point. Donnie, real quickly, your thoughts on how things played out in the first quarter of this afternoon's contest.
Well, they responded right away, which surprised me. They came right back, got the ball, drove it down the field to bring it to 7-7. And then I believe each team scored another touchdown, which brought it to 14-14. Cal pulled ahead later and then just kind of dwindled there in the third.
We, of course, ultimately will be getting to that here in a bit, as to open up things in the second quarter with 14:49 left on the clock, Longito would hit a 26-yard field goal that would bring Cal within four at that point, as they would trail OSU by the score of 14-10 at that point. And then with 2:31 left to go in the first half, Crawford would catch a 21-yard pass from Chase Garbers that, of course, would end up being a total of a four-play drive, 64-yard drive overall for Cal, as, of course, they would go into the half up by 17-14.
That's right. And then we had the halftime report, and that was a lot of fun, listening to the old goat there. And, I'm ready to get ready for basketball. Keith, next Wednesday we got the Colorado State.
Hold on. We're going to get the basketball late in the game. Let's get through this damn football game first, Donnie. And I know you're getting a little excited, getting a little ahead of yourself there, man, but relax. But we will get the basketball. It's all good, Donnie. Calm down. Be patient with everybody, Donnie. Everyone, Donnie. Maybe I shouldn't have drank before the show. Be patient with everybody, Donnie. Like you said, it is his first broadcast. A little bit of nerves in there. It's completely understandable. Yours truly knows what it was like to go through that 20 years ago. So, hey, it's all good, man.
We're going to recap the Stanfurd game later, huh?
Well, we will preview the Stanfurd game, unless somehow you have the time stone and we can look forward into the future to see what's going on with that matchup next week.
Well, we're going to keep that axe, that beautiful axe. We're going to keep it over here in Berkeley.
Anyway, before I get a little all sidetracked and stuff, third quarter opened up with pretty much a battle of field position to kick things off. And then ultimately with 6:20 left to go in the third quarter, OSU would hit a 35-yard field goal, which, of course, would cap things on a 13-play, 53-yard drive. And, of course, that would bring the Oregon State Beavers within three, as Cal at that point would lead by the score of 20-17. Fourth quarter, and Donnie pretty much already hinted at, basically late in the game, Cal kind of fading away. OSU with 13:35 left to go would hit an 8-yard touchdown pass from, of course, Tristan Jiba catching that from Tyjon Lindsey on a 6-play, 39-yard drive, which, of course, put the Beavers up by the score of 24-20. Cal with 8:04 left would take the lead. Briefly again, as they would go up 27-24 on a 2-yard touchdown pass to Jake Tongas from Chase Garbers. And with 4:30 left to go in the game, Tristan Giba would give OSU the lead on a 1-yard touchdown run, which would cap off a 3-play, 14-yard drive for the Oregon State Beavers. Cal will get the ball back and basically get damn near down near the end of the field. Chase Garbers ultimately would throw a pick late that would basically seal the deal as your California Golden Bears end up dropping this contest to the Oregon State Beavers by the final of 31-7. It was a game initially where, of course, as many of us knew that found out beforehand, several members of the offensive line, starting running back, basically a lot of key guys because of another individual on the squad testing positive for COVID-19 being held out of the game. So kind of was almost a situation where I initially was looking at it like last week's game where it's like it's frustrating. You had kind of a little bit more time, obviously, to practice with this versus the UCLA matchup last week where you basically had less than 48 hours and damn near no practice because of the positive test from the Washington game happening at that point. But basically what I'm alluding to is before that pick at the end of the game, I may not have been as frustrated with a loss in this one, but, you know, down there deep late in the game with the potential to take the lead, Chase Garbers has got to make better play selection than that, pure and simple.
He's a junior. He's got all those wins behind him. I think he should have hit the outside and just went out of bounds and gone to second down. That would have been a lot wiser.
It would have been a lot wiser to have either thrown it out of bounds, ran out of bounds, maybe even eat a sack at that point, though you really couldn't afford to eat a sack at that point because you burned all your, you know, damn, well, no, you didn't burn all your timeouts to that point, but, you know, you're trying to obviously conserve stuff. But, I mean, bottom line is, you know, this is a guy who you would think at this point would be able to make a lot better play selections than that. And, you know, it's kind of almost like this game, he kind of regressed back to some of the issues that we saw that first year that he was starting for us.
Dancy had a few shines, though. You know, Dancy tried his hardest. He's second string running back there out of Oakland, and he had a few minutes where he shined.
Well, I mean, there were guys that, you know, obviously, you know, on both sides of the ball did good. We had a couple picks during the course of the second half, but just, you know, unfortunately, the offense wasn't really able to capitalize. Even during the times over the course of this game where the offense was able to capitalize, it's almost like this game was a flashback to the Sonny Dykes era, where as soon as the offense would put points up on the game, you know, points up on the board, the defense would just turn around and cough those points right back to the other team.
We had that nice 56-yard field goal, though, during the game. That was another bright spot in the game, though.
Well, I mean, yeah, definitely. I mean, you know, it's kind of, you know, really a rarity to see college kickers, you know, hit anything from even beyond 40 yards.
Or even attempt to.
At some point. I mean, unless it's a guy that obviously, you know, if he's hitting them from that far, it's a guy that ultimately you think is going to have some NFL potential as a kicker. But, you know, at the same time, we all know better than anybody that, you know, yes, field goals do help out. They are points, but, you know, it's really going to help out more if you can get touchdowns. And this kind of alludes back to a concern that a colleague of mine who many of you all who, of course, follow A's Fan Radio are familiar with, my co-host over there, the Boss Man, concern that he has is because of the fact that Bill Musgrave is the offensive coordinator, and a lot of us got pissed off at the fact that Musgrave was so conservative when he was the Raiders offensive coordinator. There's a lot of concerns with him being too conservative with Cal. Me personally, I haven't seen anything to this point that's, you know, where I'm seeing the Bill Musgrave of the Raiders. He seems to not be as conservative at this point. Pretty much at this point, all I've really seen at this point is a team that's been unfortunately hindered by COVID-19 incidents, but at the same time, definitely today was a game that should have been winnable, that we should have won, but unfortunately was cost and lost by a mistake late in the game.
Yeah, I go with that, Keith. You got a lot of knowledge there, Keith.
Thank you, Donnie. I appreciate that. So, man, just definitely a lot of questions and concerns going forward. I'm trying not to get as livid as I obviously would in the past because I'm understanding that, you know, things starting late because of the way the Pac-12 conference handled everything, regardless how everybody feels positive and negative about that. you know, with everything starting late, many out there feeling, of course, that, you know, maybe they shouldn't have played. And, you know, I'm going to be real. Maybe sports period should have been played. But, you know, you have to understand as well that a lot of these guys pushing the issue to be played because of, you know, their potentials of wanting to play professionally down the road. And, you know, let's face it, regardless as much as we hate it, professional sports is a damn business just like everything else at this point. And it's almost to the point where college sports is kind of almost in the same boat at that point. You know, just only certain rules That's and legislations right. are really holding it from being almost, you know, ran in a business-like mentality. But just, you know, still, regardless of all those outsiding factors, just today was very frustrating for me, and I'm pretty sure it was very
I'm still having a beer from that one. That loss is brutal. We're going to have to play Stanfurd next week. We're going to have to pull it out and end up 3-2.
Bears. Well, definitely luckily for us, Stanford's been struggling as well, so maybe we can play on the advantage of the fact that both teams have been playing like butt as of late. We will go ahead and preview that matchup with the Stanfurd Cardinal. We come back at you from this break here on this second edition of the Bear Raid presented by Tightwad Hill.
The Bear Raid.
Go Bears! Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, as we continue on down the road here with the second edition of this podcast that, of course, has been over a decade plus in the making. It is the Bear Raid presented by Tightwad Hill, coming from Donnie's pad out in Concord, California. Tonight's broadcast, of course, featuring yours truly, the 30th governor of Tightwad Hill, Keith Salminen, and, of course, my co-host for tonight's broadcast, Donnie Knucklehead Hudson. Let's go ahead and continue on down the road here with this edition of the broadcast as we get set to preview the upcoming matchup next week for your California Golden Bears. First time in a while that we're actually getting it kind of around the time that we normally would. Still, obviously, would prefer it to be the last game of the year, like it used to be before this whole Pac-12 realignment happened. But obviously, as we all know, kind of can basically at this point take and be happy with what you get. And happy to even have it, pure and simple, because we thought we weren't going to even get a season at all at this point. But, of course, the next matchup on tap for your California Golden Bears going down next Friday, the 27th. It will be a 1 p.m. kickoff from the from California Memorial Stadium in Berkeley, California. What will be, of course, an empty California Memorial Stadium. And, of course, will be your California Golden Bears taking on the Stanfurd Cardinal. Donnie, real quickly, some thoughts from yours as we preview this matchup. And what is Cal going to need to do next week?
A couple double reverses, a couple end arounds. You know, we're going to razzle-dazzle. We're going to have to pull something out. The defense is going to have to rise up. They're really going to have to get excited for this game, keep that axe in Berkeley. You know, we struggled for years to get that axe back. We got to keep that axe. I think we can intercept that Stanfurd quarterback. He's a bum. And look forward to the Ducks after that.
For those wondering, by the way, Stanfurd's most recent game, which, of course, went down on Saturday, November the 14th, it was a 35-32 loss to the Colorado Buffalo. Stanfurd started off the season so far with an 0-2 record. Aside, of course, from that 35-32 loss to Colorado, they also opened up the season with a loss on November the 7th when they got their asses handed to them by the Oregon Ducks by the final of 35-14. So, first time in my recent memory that both teams have got into the big game winless. Definitely cannot say that that's happened in my lifetime. Who knows if that's happened at any point in time in this rivalry. Pretty sure at least one of these teams had probably one win at some point in time during this matchup. But it definitely adds a very bit of intrigue to this matchup, the fact that you have both teams going to this game pretty much playing like crap. Both teams, though, have been affected by COVID issues, as when I remember hearing correctly, the weekend that our game against Washington was canceled. Stanfurd had like three or four guys that tested positive for COVID. They still, of course, played that game against Oregon. And, of course, we saw got their butts handed to them.
You know, Keith, probably you're going to have too much turkey, way too much mashed potatoes and pie. And they're going to be sluggish. And like I say, we're going to play takeaway, and Cal's going to win that game, Keith.
Well, obviously, of course, as a Cal fan, I'm hoping for a win. I feel the team's better suited.
Did you hear me about the turkey? There are a bunch of turkeys.
Yeah, of course. I definitely did hear you on that. Obviously, though, one of the keys to beating Stanfurd next week is don't be making boneheaded plays like throwing a pick deep in your opponent's territory with under 2 minutes to go. If it ends up being one of those close games, because one thing is we've always seen historically with this game is the big game ends up either being a shootout or one team just murders the other team, pretty much. So just make sure, obviously, better play selection. That goes for, obviously, not just Chase Garbers. This is definitely one of those situations where, with how many of us who obviously followed Bill Musgrave of the Raiders and feel that at times he's a little too conservative, this is definitely a time where you should not be conservative at all. You know, you mentioned, like I told you all right here, Oregon carved them up the first week. It was kind of a closer matchup with Oregon with Colorado on the 14th, but I feel that this is a winnable game for Cal. Cal should be holding on to the axe when everything is said and done next Saturday, and that better be the case because I don't want to look like a complete utter jackass talking all sorts of shit to my boy Dave Covell, A's team president Dave Covell, who of course is a Stanfurd alumni, and for those of you that follow A's fan radio, you all know that for as long as Dave and I have known each other, this is basically the one time each year where Rockstar and I turn into rivals.
You know, next week we're going to be down there at 66th Avenue near the Coliseum, and you know what I got to say about that? Take off that red shirt, come on down and have a beer with me and Keith. We're going to have a good time.
I was getting ready to get into that as well. With, obviously, of course, Memorial Stadium and Tightwad Hill being closed off to the public and nobody being allowed up there to watch the games, tailgate, any of that stuff, the alternative that we came up with is to get together, of course, with our friend Grizz Jones and his guys over at Forever Oakland and basically present an outdoor viewing party / TV tailgate, I guess you can go ahead and call it. And this, of course, this venture is being presented jointly by Tightwad Hill, A's Fan Radio, and Forever Oakland. This is, of course, the 123rd big game viewing party going down out on Mob Alley. It's a setup that some of you might be a little bit familiar with. Obviously, myself, Grizz, and some of the guys from Forever Oakland and A's Fan Radio were out there on 66th Avenue doing similar events like this for the Oakland A's this year during the course of the regular season and the postseason, with obviously no fans being able to go into the ballpark. Just real quickly here, since obviously we can't access the internet on the laptop, I can still access internet on my phone, so I just want to make sure I'm pulling up all the information to give to y'all on that. So pretty much here is everything for y'all that you need to know about this viewing party that's going down. Since we can't use the Hill to watch this game, let alone any home games this season, we're teaming up with A's Fan Radio and Forever Oakland for an outdoor watch party at Mob Alley, located at 559 66th Avenue in Oakland, California, area code 94621, for the 123rd big game. Please wear face mask coverings as we will honor physical / social distancing protocol. People of all age will be welcome. Please bring potluck food and bring your own drinks as well. You're welcome to bring your own ice chest meant for the barbecue pit and or any pre-made side dishes, fruit, chips, sweets, etc. Please bring your own chairs. Also as well, Forever Oakland will have their food drive for the homeless going on. It's not mandatory to donate to that. It's optional to donate to that. Forever Oakland, of course, always welcomes any kind of essential food items and supplies to feed unhoused citizens and stray animals. For example, keep it simple as far as food items, fresh fruit and vegetables, water bottles, Capri Suns, sealed items / snacks / crackers, sandwiches, dog food, cat food, brand new hygiene supplies, hand sanitizer slash hand wipes, toothbrushes, toothpaste, tooth floss, mouthwash, skin lotion, shaving razors, shampoo, conditioner, band-aids, first aid kits, perfume, cologne, toilet paper, paper towels, and they also take clothing as well, sweatshirts, sweatpants, jackets, brand new socks, shoes and boots, blankets, sleeping bags, pillows, gloves, beanies, hats, towels, odds and ends, batteries, flashlights, and solar showers as well. So that's the rundown for it. For more information, of course, on that viewing party, be sure to visit Tightwad Hill's official Facebook page, facebook.com/Tightwad Hill Official. Click on the events section of the Facebook page. And then, of course, sorry there, by the way, as I kind of burp slash hiccup. As I'm sitting here drinking a nice, like, good drinks, Draconic Imperial Stout from Drake's Brewing Company in my hometown of San Leandro. Again, as I said, for further information and just to refresh yourself on stuff at the viewing party, like I said, hit up facebook.com/Tightwad Hill Official, go to the event page, and click on the 123rd viewing party. Obviously, you heard Donnie reference the whole take off the red shirt. We will probably be yelling at it out there. But this is probably one of the few times, given the fact that we're teaming up with multiple groups to do this, this is probably one of the few times where this will be a neutral zone, as members of Forever Oakland are also – there's at least one member of Forever Oakland that is a Stanfurd fan and has family that went – you know, that are lifelong Stanfurd fans, or, you know, members that went to Stanfurd. So we're kind of, you know – openly against our own will, per se, accepting this as a neutral ground setup versus how we would handle stuff on Tightwad Hill, which is, yeah, you know, no red shirt period. But I'm definitely looking forward to going out there. What about you, Donnie? This will be the first time you've made your way out to Mob Alley.
Well, I'm going to come out to the Mob Alley. I'm going to hang out with the mobsters, you know. That's where I belong. You know, I grew up in Oakland and went to the A's games when I was a little kid, and those Raiders and those Oakland Invaders. Now it's all about my Cal Bears. I've been a big Cal Bear for a long time, and I'm really looking forward to going out there and having some fun. I want you to all come down and hang with us. Bring your chair. I heard the weather's going to be great. You know, bring your rolling papers. You might need those.
Oh, you definitely most likely will probably need those. The 123rd Big Game Watch Party at Mob Alley, presented by Tightwad Hill, A's Fan Radio, and Forever Oakland. Once again, that, of course, is next Friday the 27th, in accordance, of course, with the big game going down between Stanfurd and Cal. Again, we will be holding that watch party out on what's referred to as Mob Alley. Mob Alley, of course, is located at 559 66th Avenue, Oakland, California, 94621. And of course, again, for more information on that, be sure to visit the Tightwad Hill Facebook page, which of course is facebook.com/Tightwad Hill Official. The event, of course, is jointly co-hosted by A's Fan Radio and Tightwad Hill, so you can also get information for the event in regards to that on either A's Fan Radio's Facebook page or Forever Oakland's Facebook page as well.
Some people call me the Space Cowboy, some people call me Mob Gangster of Love.
That actually reminds me, and I kind of feel like Donnie almost intentionally did that. For those of you out there wondering, most likely, why we ended up using the same intro music for this show, I'm going to go ahead and give that little tidbit of history for y'all right now, because I'm pretty sure I didn't share that on last week's show. So the reason why the entrance intro music for the last show, this show, and until further notice, pretty much every Bear Raid broadcast going forward is The Joker by the Steve Miller Band, is because in the mid-2000s, yours truly was basically entrusted with bringing the sound system to Tightwad Hill, basically, which is, it didn't matter if it was a boombox, some sort of CD player or cassette player with some sort of portable speakers on it. Just somehow, some way, yours truly was basically in charge of mixing the music on game day in the 2000s up on Tightwad Hill, after I became part of the mix after the big game in 2002. As we got Donnie over here pulling up the harmonica. So One of the things that basically I did one day is part of one of these mixes I put together is I threw the Joker by the Steve Miller Band on there and just happened to have it be the first song set to play on that playlist that day. And it was just crazy and just weird and just, you know, just ultimately, I guess, just that whole vibe and camaraderie and the, you know, the community that basically Tightwad Hill has become in its 90 plus years of existence. The moment that song started playing, just everybody that was up there started singing in unison with it. Just the moment it dropped, just all you hear up there is just everybody doing the whole, singing along to it. And the one thing that everybody did on cue, obviously when it gets to the chorus, for y'all that are familiar with it, is I'm a joker, I'm a smoker. When it got, of course, to the point in the song where it said I'm a midnight toker, every single one of us that were on the hill that day and pretty much multiple days going forward in the years preceding, following that, screamed, I'm a midnight toker, at the top of our lungs. And it was basically a tradition we carried on for pretty much the remainder of the 2000s. We've kind of, you know, fallen off a little bit with that over the years. Something maybe I need to try to bring back to just add to a little bit of the history that I'm involved on there. But, yeah, that's pretty much the reason right there, ladies and gentlemen, why the Joker let off last week's show, why the Joker let off this week's show, and like I just told y'all, the Joker will basically lead off every edition of the Bear Raid.
You know, Wilcox, he's going to bring us the win next week. You know, I'm sitting here listening to Keith about that story, and it's a great story, Keith. I didn't know about that. It's before my time. But Wilcox, he's going to bring us next week. He's going to beat up on that defense in practice this week. And I think we'll come home and with a win, you know.
Definitely hope so. I mean, hey, definitely is going to be, you know, really looking at it. If you're an outsider, you know, we might be being a little biased, being Cal fans favoring us to win. You're an outsider looking in, though, obviously, you know, it really could potentially go either way. But I feel that we have the better team on the field and we'll end up on top of things. But just, again, you got to make sure you avoid shit like what happened at the end of the game against Oregon State today, and you will end up taking the axe back into Berkeley next week.
So, Keith, 123 years ago, did they really play with a pigskin? Wow.
Who knows what they were playing with 123 years ago? They could have been playing with a pigskin, dogskin, catskin, whaleskin. Who the hell knows what they were? I wasn't around 123 years ago. I have no idea what they were playing with.
But you're such a historian. I figure I'd just ask.
Yeah, not an interesting thing to throw at. You know, would be nice a little bit more of a heads up so I could have, you know, looked up that. But you know, I wouldn't be surprised if they were using pigskin. But you know. Who the hell knows what they were using at that point?
Who was the quarterback 123 years ago, Keith?
Did they even have quarterbacks back then? I thought they did mainly running plays 123 years ago. I thought they didn't do forward passes 123 years ago.
Yeah, I don't think they had the forward pass. They probably threw it backwards and then they kicked it.
Yeah, it probably looked more like rugby 123 years ago than what it looks like now. So definitely looking forward to next week, the 123rd big game between your University of California Golden Bears and the Stanfurd Cardinal, not Stanford. Stanfurd, spelled Stanfurd. And, of course, as mentioned, be sure to come out and join us for the 123rd big game viewing party presented by Tightwad Hill, A's Fan Radio, and Forever Oakland out there at Mob Alley in Oakland, California. Just a reminder, of course, face masks and social distancing will be mandatory. If you have a problem with that, don't bother to show up. It's just that pure and simple, because many of us out there, we're not trying to catch this stupid-ass damn virus. On that note, let's go ahead and take our final break of tonight's broadcast. When we come back, Donnie will finally get to talk some Cal men's and women's basketball. We will take, of course, a look at the current standings in the Pac-12 for Pac-12 football, and then, of course, mine and Donnie's final thoughts before we get on out of here. Don't go anywhere, folks. Final segment of show number 2 of the Bear Raid, presented by Tightwad Hill, coming at you here in a bit.
Last
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, as we get set to head on into what will be the final segment of this broadcast, the second broadcast of a podcast that, of course, is over 10-plus years in the making, finally made its debut last Sunday. Still working on trying to figure out what kind of regular schedule we will be bringing at you as far as this goes. And again, as mentioned, if any of you out there that follow this show happen to see Tad Dillinger III roaming around Berkeley,
Taddy, tell, where are you?
Tell Taddy to get in contact with us so that way he can join me and Donnie on doing these, because Tad's one of the guys that helped push this whole idea for yours truly here to do a Cal-themed version of what I was already doing with A's Fan Radio, what I had been doing on and off with my mentors over at Raider Fan Radio for many years. And, yeah, please, if any of you out there see Taddy, or Tad, if you happen to be watching this through one of your various burner accounts on social media, get in contact with one of us, Yoo-hoo, so we can bring you on this damn show finally.
I got a cigar for you, Dad. I got a cigar for you.
Yeah. Donnie has a liquor store literally right across the street from his house, so he can just go right over there and get you several cigars if you wanted to bring you out here. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Show number 2 of the Bear Raid presented by Tightwad Hill with the 30th governor of Tightwad, Keith Salminen, and Donnie Knucklehead Hudson getting ready to close things out with y'all here from Donnie's pad out in Concord, California. It's the point in the show that Donnie's been antsing like a little schoolgirl to get to. He almost looks damn near almost as overexcited as Dave Newhouse was to talk playoff baseball in 2012 when he came on A's Fan Radio. Ladies and gentlemen, Donnie Knucklehead will be taking it away here with y'all for the next several minutes to talk Cal basketball, and this, of course, will be Cal basketball for not just the men, but the women as well. Donnie, take it away.
Well, you know, first it's the dudes. We're starting up there in Corvallis, Oregon, in the bubble. They're going to have all the teams in the Pac-12, I guess, up there in the bubble. We're playing Colorado State next Wednesday. Go Bears! You know, we got some stars on the team. I'm looking at the roster sheet here. We got a guy named Lars. He plays center and forward. He's 7 foot tall. And we got a couple stars I heard about. Joel Brown, he plays guard, 6'2". We got Jared Hyder. Oh, come on, Jared. Let's play some basketball out there in Berkeley. The women, they start next Wednesday also. They're playing against San Jose State Spartans at 4 o'clock. They're going to follow it up on 12-4, which is Friday night. That's against the Huskies. And USC is supposed to be one of the best teams, but I think when they come up here and play Cal, we got some basketball to poke in their eye.
Sorry about that, ladies and gentlemen. I had my mic turned off there for a little bit. It's a little bit shocking, and both Donnie and I were looking at that, looking at this before we did tonight's show. We all know that, obviously, over the years, the Cal men's basketball team can be a little bit streaky at times. Sometimes there's years where they have moments of greatness, but more often than not, it seems like basically ever since Jason Kidd was on the team, they've been basically complete, utter garbage. The women's team, though, on the other hand, is usually pretty dominant. It seems like more often than not, going into most seasons, they're usually somewhere in the top 25, and I was actually a little shocked, and Donnie was kind of shocked to not see them in the top 25 this year.
Well, maybe they could rise up and, you know, get ranked after a couple weeks. I was looking at some of the performances. They look really good.
Definitely be interesting to see what happens with that, and of course, as we all mentioned to y'all, obviously one of the main focal points behind the show when we basically been kicking around the idea for it for the last several years was, yes, the main focal point and the main inspiration behind it was covering Cal football. But as mentioned, Donnie's hinted at he wants to cover and recap and do stuff with Cal basketball. Those of you that are obviously familiar with my work with A's Fan Radio, you already know that besides Cal football, I'm going to want to talk Cal baseball at some point. And let's face it, the one sport for sure that has to be covered on this show even though they're not playing right now, but we will obviously cover when they play, and they have to be covered because of the fact that they gloriously kill everybody that they face. Y'all know that when it comes time to it, we're going to be talking Cal Rugby on this show at some point, but basically that's always been my intent with this show is, even though, yes, not a lot of the initial focus was going to be probably on Cal football, like I've told y'all on last week's show, and I will continue to say it on this week's show and every show going forward, and a lot of you out there that have heard me talk about this idea, as this show expands, I wanted to ultimately cover all of Cal athletics.
Hey, who's this guy number 13? 6'9" forward? Kuwani. Hey, that's freaking cool. You know, I'm looking through the roster of men's basketball here. We got a lot of experience. I don't know why we didn't get ranked. We got a guy named DJ Thorpe, even. Number 33. And then we got this guy from, he's from Greece, actually. He's 6'6". He's a guard. And his name is Demetrius. Come on, Bears. Let's get this Coach Fox moving. And maybe we can get on the map.
Definitely will be an interesting season going forward for both basketball programs. And obviously a year that initially, just like with Cal football, many of us back in August thought that all of fall sports was going to be canceled out. But obviously the student athletes, obviously we all know about the push that the student athletes, not just in Cal football, but across the Pac-12 pushed to ultimately play. But obviously as well, you saw that from a lot of the athletes and all the other fall sports as well, because, you know, again, and I iterated it earlier in the show, regardless how some of us feel about the fact that maybe not just college sports, obviously, but professional sports maybe should be taking a back seat and not be happening at all this year, we also have to be real and acceptive of the fact, regardless if we like it or not, that sports is a business, and a lot of these student athletes are intending, or at least trying to intend, to get to the next level of their sport. So you can't blame them for wanting to put pressure on the rest of the conference to want to be able to have fall sports play so that way they can be able to live their dream out at the next level. You know, some of us may not agree with that, but, you know, that's just the nature of the beast, and regardless of how you feel about that, you pretty much have to accept that as it is. Donnie, any final thoughts on Cal men's and women's basketball before we do the Pac-12 football standings?
Not really. I think I summed it up. Hey, do we have a fishing team? I love fishing.
That I don't know, but I may have to look that up. That's obviously something that we're going to have to look up. And I did mention this on last week's show. I want to continue to reiterate it, obviously, not just on this show, but any show going forward. Any of you fellow Cal fans out there, and even some of you former Cal student athletes, if you want to contribute to this broadcast, feel free to. Shoot us a recording. If you want to come and join us or do something over Zoom or pre-record something, you know, it'd be nice to have you come and join us, but obviously given the circumstances of this damn pandemic going around, it may not be the smartest thing to do at that point, at this point in time. But you want to submit something for your, you know, the various sport you like or the sport you follow, something that we may not have talked about at this point, shoot something to me on Facebook or even on Twitter. Shoot something to Donnie on Facebook, or even shoot something to either facebook.com/tightwadhillofficial or at tightwadhill23 on Twitter. You know, again, I want to ultimately get this show to the point where we're covering all aspects of Cal athletics and not just the stuff that
swimming, rowing, tennis, rugby, you name it. We got a lot of athletics here in Cal.
Yeah, bottom line is I don't want this show to just be dedicated to the sports that those of us here that, you know, myself, Donnie, and Tad, you know, I don't want it to be just limited to the sports that the three of us follow. I want to ultimately get it to the point where everything else is involved. So, again, any of you all want to join us, contribute something, fire it our way. Again, facebook.com/tightwadhillofficial or at tightwadhill23 on Twitter. Or, again, if you know mine and Donnie's personal Facebook page, which is...
Well, you know, 95.7 has a woman there in the morning now, Kate Scott. She's a big shot here in Bay Area radio. So ladies are welcome as well, of course.
Oh, yeah, definitely, and I should definitely put that out there as well. I don't give a damn if you're a man, if you're a woman, if you're a man that identifies as a woman, if you're a woman that identifies as a man. You got something that is contributive, that pertains to Cal athletics, hit us up. We'll be interested in it. Let's go ahead now and take a look at the current Pac-12 North and Pac-12 South standings the Pac-12's football divisions at this point. We'll obviously, of course, start off first with the Pac-12 North because your University of California Golden Bears play in the Pac-12 North. Currently, right now, the Oregon Ducks sit on top of the Pac-12 North with a record of 3-0. The Washington Huskies are in the second spot with a record of 1-0. The Washington State Cougars are in the middle of the are in the third spot currently with a record of 1-1. The Oregon State Beavers, after defeating Cal today, are in the fourth spot with a record of 1-2. Stanfurd and Cal are tied for the basement right now in the Pac-12 North with records of 0-2. Over in the Pac-12 South, you currently have the Colorado Buffalo leading the division with a record of 2-0. They're not the only undefeated team, though, as technically there is a tie for the top of the division in the Pac-12 South. That team that's tied with Colorado for 2-0, who else, of course? None other than the USC Trojans. You have Utah sitting at 0-0. Not shocked. Still dealing with COVID stuff, obviously, so Utah still has yet to play a damn game, even as of today. The UCLA Dickless Bears are in the fourth spot with a record of 1-2 and tied at 0-1 at the bottom of the Pac-12 South right now are the Arizona Wildcats and the Arizona State Sun Devils.
What's so wild about that?
Nothing really. It looks like basically both Arizona teams are stuck in the basement because of COVID issues, kind of similar almost to what both Bay Area teams are at this point. Not really shocked by what USC's doing. I mean, let's face it, us Cal fans, we all hate USC, but it's just, it's ridiculous, you know, some of the talent they bring down there.
Keith, you know we could beat Alabama tomorrow if we really tried.
Dude, we could probably kick half the teams in the SEC's ass at this point because half the teams are infected by COVID. We'd have the advantage because they probably have more infected players than we do at this point.
I think they'd be scared to come out here in Berkeley and play us.
Maybe they will, but, you know, I mean, I'm not shocked seeing USC tied there in the South. I am kind of shocked seeing Colorado tied there at the top of the division because, really, Colorado's almost been a zero factor, at least on the football side, since it's joined the Pac-12. It was a team that had a lot of success before it was in the Pac-12, and I know this because of, you know, a friend of mine that used to be,
What about De La Salle High School? Do they get the championship? You know, they don't even play, and they just...
Screw De La Salle. I still hate those cats because of the fact that's the only team my boy Dennis Dixon couldn't beat when he was the quarterback at San Leandro High, something you and I were talking about before the broadcast earlier today.
That's right.
But, you know, you kind of look at things, it's really maybe per se in both divisions. It might be, you know, some situations you could say teams are running away. Others may not be. And again, it's a season where a lot of things are just going to really hinge from week to week because of COVID-19. And, you know, this is coming from somebody who, again, I mentioned, I really thought that the reality is that sports as a whole should have been shut down, but at the same time, for those of you that know me real well and know about what happened with my aunt, sports has kind of served as an escape for me kind of at this point, so double-edged sword. As I kind of lose my train of thought here, unfortunately, at the moment. But
I like your logo you made there, Keith. It's the Bear Raid.
It's really nice.
I love that.
Basically, I use the Blade Runner font for that because one of the programs I have in my laptop had that font on there, so I figured I would go with that. But
that's a good choice.
Kind of piggying back to what I was saying before I lost my train of thought is I guess you can say it's a season where looking at some of this stuff, you could kind of maybe initially say that some teams could potentially run away with things and whatnot, but because of the pandemic being in place and because of the fact that from week to week you don't know what's going to happen, maybe there is some potential for Cal to get back into the mix with this, but I hate to say it at this point. It's going to take a lot from not just Cal, but things to play out with other teams for Cal to ride back to the top of things in the Pac-12 North.
Hey, Keith, you know, I was just thinking, how's Dunn doing, our buddy Dunn there on the hill? I haven't seen him in a while.
It's been a minute since I've seen Well, actually, no, I talked to Dunn from here and there. He obviously, he's very active on social media, like the rest of us.
How about the chicken? How's the chicken doing?
Chicken's doing great as far as I know. And, of course, shout out to Duncan, by the way. He'll probably be tuning into this at some point, because I know he's been tuning, he tuned into the debut show, and he tuned into, he's been tuning into several A's fan radio broadcasts as well. But, yeah, him and the chicken are doing great. They had hoped to, they were hoping to join us for the viewing party out there between Cal and Stanfurd, but I guess he has some other engagement that's going down that night, so he won't be able to join us, but he will be there in spirit, as will be the chicken.
That's right. The chicken's always in spirit.
Before we get on out of here, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to go ahead and, I guess you can say, kind of do something similar to what many of you might have seen me and my boys do over on A's Fan Radio, and that's a little bit of a final thought, per se. So tonight's final thought, I will go ahead and let my co-host, Donnie Knucklehead, lead things off. Donnie, take it away with your final thought of tonight's broadcast.
Well, this is Howard Cosell, Keith. Did you ever work with Howard Cosell? Monday Night Football, Howard Cosell, how you doing? Oh, sorry about that.
Bear Raid Radio exclusive.
That's right. This is Donnie Knucklehead Hudson. Thanks for that handle there, Keith. I appreciate the new name. That's going to be my handle. Back to my basketball. Go Bears. You know, nobody's allowed around Haas Pavilion, and respect that. And hopefully we'll get some places to view it. I'd like to see some outdoor viewing parties. And I look forward to doing the show again next week with Keith here after the big victory. Bring that axe home, baby. Bring it home. And that's it. Thank you.
Taddy, remember, if you're out there, you can finally possibly come and join us for our third broadcast. But, yeah, that's on you. So, yeah, again, anybody, if you see Tad, tell him to get in contact with us or come join us out on Mob Alley next week. As always, ladies and gentlemen, for the latest information pertaining to the Bear Raid presented by Tightwad Hill, be sure to visit facebook.com/TightwadHillOfficial. Follow at TightwadHill23 on Twitter. Visit aysfanradio.com/TheBearRaid presented by Tightwad Hill to see everything pretty much pertaining to the Bear Raid at that point. You can view our live show broadcasts when we're able to do live show broadcasts on A's Fan Radio's Twitch channel at twitch.tv/A's Fan Radio. And, of course, past recordings of the Bear Raid until we finally decide to the point if we want to get our own YouTube channel or not. For the time being, recordings of the Bear Raid can be viewed over on A's Fan Radio's YouTube channel, which, again, is right there on your screen. I don't feel like uttering all that, and I really hope at some point that once we get some more views on there, I can actually just register the damn YouTube channel as youtube.com/A's Fan Radio. But for the time being, that web address in front of y'all is the web address. My final thoughts. Hi, Dave. And if you don't know who I'm talking about when I say Dave, I'm, of course, talking about my boy Dave Cobble, who is the team president of the Oakland Athletics. It's that time of year again, my man, where you and I become adversaries for a week. Don't think because of the fact that you've won the axe nine out of the last ten times in the last decade, that you guys are going to get that bad boy back relatively quickly. Yes, both of our teams are going into this matchup next Friday playing like complete, pure, what's the word I should use? Utter dog shit, for more lack of term thereof. Both our teams suck. That's just the pure definition of that. But, yeah. I'm going to tell you here, right now, Mr. Rockstar, if you think that that axe is going to be going back with that ugly ass excuse for a mascot.
I feel a shellacking coming on.
That pathetic, ridiculous excuse for a band and your football team. I got some oceanfront property in Arizona for sale for you that you can go and hang out with at whenever you're down in Arizona for spring training. Love you to death, Dave. Respect you. You are a homeboy, but sorry, my man. I'm predicting that when it's all said and done, it will be a close one. It will be a shootout. I predict a 35-28 victory for your California Golden Bears over your Stanfurd Cardinal, Dave, the axe is staying in the East Bay when it's all said and done next Friday night. On behalf of my man, Donnie Knucklehead Hudson, and Tad Dillinger III, wherever the bloody hell he's at out there in UC Berkeley, I am the 30th governor of Tightwad Hill, Keith Salminen. Thank you all, as always, for tuning in to the Bear Raid. We will catch you all next week when we come at you. My bad, as I accidentally prematurely set off the music there. Thank you all for tuning in. We will come at you and see you all when we come at you from Mob Alley next Friday night.
Until then, have a good Thanksgiving.
The views and opinions of our cast, our guests, and our listeners are in no way, shape, or form affiliated with the University of California Golden Bears, California Golden Bear football, NCAA football, or the NCAA overall. Thank you all again, ladies and gentlemen, for tuning in to this young and up-and-coming show. Definitely looking forward to bringing more stuff at you. And again, as I mentioned and as Donnie mentioned, this is more about just Cal football and the stuff that we from Tightwad Hill want to cover, ladies and gentlemen. We are definitely interested in any of you out there that would like to partake in this and share your thoughts on other Cal sports. Until next week, ladies and gentlemen, take care, good night, and go Bears! Beat Stanfurd.